Hallelujah. Praise God. I was sitting there listening to that song. There's a couple lines in that song, you know, about take my mind and transform it, or my life and transform it, and take my will, praise God, take my will and let it be conformed into God's will. Words to that effect. But we've often said that phrase, our will has to be swallowed up in His will and God's will for our life. And as I said, I say this about every time I preach back home. I don't know why the Lord does what He does, but He knows how to get to me. He knows, you know, He always has a song prepared for me. They'll tell you, people that know me, when it comes to music ministry, the praise and the worship, I don't take it lightly. Y'all don't know how blessed you are to have the praise and worship you have here. There's not many churches that even have one singer. It's not to me, some of them don't have anything at all, and y'all are blessed to have that. But, you know, every time I get up to preach, I'll be seeking the Lord and laboring. If you're called to preach, you know what I'm talking about. Preachers, they labor. I tell my wife all the time, she's like, I kind of get on her nerves sometimes, because sometimes I'm pacing. Sometimes it's hard to go to bed at night. It's just, Don knows what I'm talking about. You know, sometimes, you know, we struggle trying to find the mind of the Lord. But that line in that song, you know, I was seeking the Lord on what to start with. And I want to start with this right here, and we'll see how it goes. Turn with me to 1 Peter. I've been looking at Peter a lot here lately. Last time I preached back home, I preached a message about Peter. I'm not going to use all the same material that I used last time I preached, but I can't get away from it. I can't get away from the life of Peter, referring to the will, because Peter is our example. Peter, if there's ever an example of self-will, through the failures, through the struggles. Y'all, everybody knows about the denial. You know, everybody, we like to point a finger at Peter. You know, look what he done. But one thing we know about Peter, that he's an example of our life. He didn't quit. And if there's ever an example, we like to say the Apostle Paul is probably we've heard this said before, and I agree, this is probably the greatest example, humanly speaking, of Christianity that Christ has ever produced. And it's probably the Apostle Paul because of course, the new covenant God gave him. Christ gave him the meaning of the new covenant. And he gave him, 13 or 14 epistles in the New Testament. And he's probably the greatest example. But Peter learned from Paul. If there's ever a great example, I can't think of any greater example of humility than Peter. And I want to open up with this verse. First of all, before I go any further, I want to say thanks again to Sister Carrie, Brother Don, for inviting us over. It's such an honor. It's such a privilege to be able to stand here. You know. Sometimes I feel like I'm the peon of preachers, and I'm not one of those that shucks the corn like Don. Y'all may have heard, if y'all been here long enough, you may have heard Don say that phrase. He used to say it back home a lot. Because a lot of times Brother Don would get up after Brother Wayne. It used to be just Brother Voss and Don on Sunday. And Don would fill in he would preach on Sunday afternoon. And a lot of times after a good message, after Brother Wayne preached, such a powerful message, Brother Don get up and say, Brother Wayne shucked the corn. Brother Wayne shucked the corn this morning. And Don, in my opinion, is one of those corn shuckers, corn shucking preachers. He gets up here, and I'm not one of those that can shuck the corn, but I want the Lord to have His way. Praise God. But I've learned a lot from Brother Don, and I hope to get into it in my message at some point. I'm going to try not to keep y'all too long. No more than 3 hours. Just kidding. But, you know, I've learned a lot from Brother Wayne. I've learned a lot from Brother Don over the years, because it used to be just us three. And, you know, we got Luke now that's joined us, and Brother Tom Wilson. And I just thank the Lord for what He's doing in Crossway Ministries. And And I've known the Ragsdales since 2010. They came over there with us, and I actually seen Brother Don once before at a meeting we had. Lauren Larson came, I think it was around 2008 or 9. I seen him one time. I spoke to him that night, but I didn't really get to know him, meet him until 2010. I thank the Lord for them. But I'm going to tell you, I like to say this, not in a negative way to pick on Brother Don, but if you can handle Brother Don's preaching, I'm here to tell you right now, because it goes along with my message. If you can take it, you can make it. If you can take the preaching of the cross, not personality. See, we got to lay aside all the personality, all the, you know, the style, the, you know, the introduction. I mean, the presentation. People have their eyes on man. You know, but I've learned a lot from Brother Don. I learned a lot from Brother Wayne. I just thank the Lord for them. They are what you call their trophies of grace, and they're an example in this day for their boldness to be able to stand. And I just thank the Lord for them. But anyway, let's go to the Word of God. I'm going to start with this scripture because, I was seeking the Lord for an introduction for the verse to start with, and then we're going to go to some more scriptures. But Peter wrote in 1 Peter chapter 5, and I'm going to start right here in verse 10, "But the God of all grace, who has called us unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that you have suffered a while, make you perfect." That means knit together. That means complete. You know, knit together with the Spirit. "Establish, strengthen, and settle you. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. By Silas, a faithful brother unto you, as I suppose I have written briefly, exhorting and testifying that this is the true grace of God wherein you stand." I'll stop right there for now in my reading. If you go back and look at the previous chapters, the previous verses, Peter mentions a lot about grace. He mentions a lot about humility. He talked about the devil. He mentions a lot throughout Peter's epistles. We see a lot. There's a constant theme that keeps coming up. And it's trials and, you know, the fiery trial. Think it not strange, that fiery trial that's come to try you, as though some strange thing happened. That's one of the most familiar verses that Peter uttered. And he talked about trial. I mean, over and over. I've seen over and over he talked about trials a lot. And Peter was able to write these things. And the reason I started with this is it has to do with that song, you know, self-will, about will, because the phrase in verse 10, "After you have suffered a while, make you perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you." That suffering is not beating your back with a whip. It's not this hard, not necessarily this hardship or whatever, you know, those things that can go along with it, these things we go through. But the idea here has to do with that point of, you know, the flesh, from the flesh to the Spirit. And if we'd be honest this morning, we all are still in the process of growing. Self-will don't die easy, or the flesh don't die easily. But the reason Peter is an example, because he was able to take it. I come to preach a message this morning with that title: "If you can take it, you can make it." And Peter is our example, because he didn't get mad when Paul rebuked him. That's why I mentioned in my introduction about Don. If you can take the preaching that's sitting behind his pulpit, because I know Brother Don. I love Brother Don. And I don't get offended by the message. If you get offended by the message, you're in the wrong house. There's plenty of churches down the road that'll tickle your ear. And if you love the truth, this is for those that love the truth this morning. If you love the truth, then you know what I'm talking about. But Peter, after being rebuked by Paul in Galatians 2:11, Paul gave that account of, you know, how he stood him to the face. He withstood Peter because he was to blame, because he was involved in some. He was double-minded in a sense. He was being hypocritical. You know the story about how, you know, Peter was eating with the Gentiles. trying to tell them about the love of Christ and, you know, about the message, you know, about Jesus dying for them. But when the Jews come over there, he, out of fear of man, that's what we get. See, that's a self-will right there. You know, self getting in the way and fear of man. He went over to the other side, and anyway, and you know the story about that. And Paul rebuked him for that. He confronted him about that. And then I look back in Peter's life, how Jesus, not only Paul, he took it from Jesus when, you know, Jesus was talking about he was going to Jerusalem. In Matthew chapter 16, Jesus told the disciples that I must go to Jerusalem and be killed, and I'll rise again on the third day. You know, I'll be offered up. I will give my life in Jerusalem. And Peter took Jesus by the shoulder, so to speak, however he did it, and turned him around and said, "Be it far from you, Lord. This thing shall not be," you know, because he didn't understand the cross. And there's still a segment of the church today that doesn't understand this kind of preaching. They don't understand the cross. And Peter was rebuked by Jesus, basically. Now think about it. You see, a lot of people want to say, well, Jesus wouldn't talk like that. Jesus wouldn't have said that. But Jesus turned him around and basically rebuked him and said, "Get behind me, Satan. For you are an offense unto me. For you savor not the things that be of God, but those things that be of man." You see, flesh always tends toward man. You know, the self-will always wants to satisfy self, you know, and we want to do it our way. We don't want, you know, we don't like the way he said that. You know, that's why there's so many different churches. That's why, you know, people start different churches, not for the reason this church was started. God started this church.
Amen.
See, I know God started this church, but a lot of times man starts a church. A lot of times the reason there's a split in the church is because of the offense. You know, just like the early church was a tongue-talking church. You know, it was a spirit-filled church. And that's why there's denominations that was, a lot of them were started because they didn't like tongues. They didn't like, you know, the moving of the Holy Spirit. See, people shun the moving and operation of the Holy Spirit if they're not grounded and settled. If they're not come to the point like Peter learned. He learned to suffer in the flesh, that growth, that process of growth. He learned to suffer and become the man of God instead of getting mad and walking out and bailing out. So the message I come to talk about today, if God has positioned this church, and I know he has, he's raised up this church, and some of you have already said to me by mouth that God has called you here, and there's others of you that you feel that God is leading you here. And I have 3 points I want to bring out. And over Matthew, start with Matthew 16. Now, I do a lot of reading when I preach. I just bear with me. I read a lot of scriptures. Praise God. Matthew 16. See, we gotta have a solid faith. We gotta have a solid rock faith. If we're gonna be able to take it in these last days. I got that phrase, by the way, from Brother Tom Wilson. I stole that phrase. He hadn't ever used it as a title of a message, but I borrowed that phrase from Brother Tom Wilson. He says that if you can take it, you can make it. I said, hey, that's a good title for this message. If you can take it, you can make it. Praise God. I like that, because see, we got to be able to take some things. We got to be able to endure these trials. See, the reason Peter was able to write about these trials, if you just do a study on 1 Peter, I don't have time to read them all. If you do a study on the epistles of Peter, you'll see the reason he was able to write about all these things is because he passed the test. Even though at times it looked like he failed the test, yes, naturally, at times he failed the test. He found himself on his face. But he repented. See, that's the difference. He wept bitterly when he denied the Lord. He loved his Lord. And he loved his Lord when, I love it, in John chapter 21, when, you know, after the death and resurrection of Christ, and Peter's self-will, see, even after all the things that he went through, even after all the miracles he saw with Jesus, he still had that, see, throughout his life, that self-will was still there. We see it in the early church. That's why Paul had to rebuke him. You know, that's why even after he was filled with the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost, he gave that powerful message on the day of Pentecost, and thousands of souls were saved. But then, what long after that, he found himself being hypocritical. You know, what long? You know, he still had that struggle with self, even after he was anointed and preaching this gospel. Hey, you know what? It reminds me. I'm looking in the mirror right now. It reminds me. I'm glad that mirror's there, because I can look at that mirror and say, because I'm preaching to myself today. Praise God. Hallelujah. I'm preaching to myself. When I hear about Peter, I'm preaching to myself. That's me when I see Peter. That's why I love Peter. That's why I love Peter the big fisherman so much. That's why I love him, because he is an example of humility. And oh my Lord, let me get him. There's so much I want to say. Oh, I'm trying to settle down. Let's pray right now, Father. Thank you. Father, I thank you right now, Lord, for this message. I know you've given me a message to give to your people. I thank you for the praise and worship. I thank you for what you've already done. Lord, I thank you for your Spirit moving. I feel at home here. Lord, I've been in other churches before where it was hard to preach. It was hard. The moment I got up, I felt tension. I felt like I wasn't welcome, but I feel welcome here, Lord. I thank you for this family. I thank you for this church. I ask you to bless them, Lord. And I'm asking, Lord, that you hide me in the cross right now, Lord, that you would speak through me. You'd say the things that only your Spirit can say today. That in spite of my stuttering and my struggles, your Holy Spirit will fill in the gap. Your Spirit will fill in the things I'm not able to say to the people, Lord, that they would leave here knowing that they heard, they'd be encouraged, they'd leave here challenged and encouraged, Lord, by your Spirit. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Matthew 16. I got 3 points I want to bring out, with actually 3 passages of Scripture. I'm going to do all time will allow. We're going to see how it goes. But over in Matthew 16, Jesus is starting in verse 13. And when Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, "Whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" And they said, "Some say that you are John the Baptist, some Elijah, and others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." He said unto them, "But whom you say that I am?" That's something we need to think about. That. See, we need to examine our heart today. We need to ask ourselves that. Jesus is asking us, "Who do you say I am?" See, it matters who we think Jesus is. It means a lot what you say about Jesus. What is your view of Jesus? How are you looking at Jesus? And then I'll go on to say, as the message comes out, our determination and our staying in this place that God has called us and in this message that God has called us, it all boils down to how you view the message, how you view Jesus, first of all, and how you view the message, how you're looking at it, because Jesus said, "Take heed." I notice in Luke chapter 8, he said, "Take heed." In one of them, he said, "How you hear," and in Mark, I got it in my notes, he said, "Take heed how you hear," because there's another message I preached, and I went back to that. And then in one of them, he said, "Take heed what you hear." See, we need to take heed. Yeah, Mark 4:24, he said unto them, "Take heed what you hear." And then in Luke 8:18, he said, "Take heed how you hear." And then he talked about, so that was in the parable of the sower, the seed and the sower, which goes along with it. I'm just kind of putting it out there. I was seeking the Lord on how I was going to preach this, if I was going to go to the parable of the sower and preach out of that. But see, I want to go ahead and say it because it goes along with it. You know, if you're in good soil, good ground, and I'm here to tell you there's some good ground here. In Southaven, there's some good ground in Greenwood. I preached a message a few months back called "Good Ground." There's some good ground in those churches that's being established, where God has called these men and women of God to raise up these churches. Do you know how blessed you are today? Do you know what you have here? Do you really know? Are you taking it for granted? Do you know what God has wrought, what God is doing here in Southaven? And I want to preach this message to try to encourage you, to challenge you to get on board with what God is doing here. And the only way you'll be able to do that is you got to be able to endure some things that's going to come along. Some of you are already going through some hardships. Some of you are already going through some financial difficulties. Some of you, you're going through some things. You know, and when I hear these things mentioned that we're going through, I say we, because I ain't just preaching down on y'all. We're going through some things. When I hear these things, that confirms my message. Because see, we got to be able to take these things that we go through, these trials, if we're going to get on board with what God is doing. Let me read on, because I want to preach before I get started preaching. Hallelujah. And they said, some say that you are John the Baptist, some Elijah, and others Jeremiah, one of the prophets. And he said unto them, but whom you say that I am? And Simon Peter answered and said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered and said unto him, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood have not revealed it unto you, but my Father who is in heaven. If you're saved today, the Holy Spirit's done revealed it to you. If you truly are saved, if you truly have seen Jesus, and you believe, whether you understand the message of the cross in its entirety or not, hey, we all going to learn until we breathe our last breath. You can't exhaust this Word of God. You can't exhaust the message of the cross. We're still learning things about it. And Peter had a revelation of who Jesus was. And we'll read on a little bit later. He didn't understand what he came to do. He didn't understand the cross. But he believed in him. And he was saved by saying, how many of you know today that believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved? If you'd be honest today, you know you got saved before you understood the message of the cross in its entirety. You know, I got saved in a drug rehab, laying flat on my back in 1999 in a drug rehab. I was bound and I was tired of myself. I come to the end of myself. Until you come to the end of yourself today, I may be preaching to the choir, but you need to hear this. Until you come to the end of yourself today, you're not going to see Jesus for who He is. You're not going to have a revelation. And Peter knew there was, he had the words of eternal life. He said it over in another place in John chapter 6, when many walked away because of the cross. They couldn't take the cross. They couldn't take the offense of the cross. In John 6:60, they said, some of His disciples said, this is a hard saying. Who can hear it? See, how you hear it determines if you're going to stay. How you see it, how you view it. And many walked away in John 6:66. I found that interesting. 6:66, I found that interesting. In John 6:66, many of His disciples walked away and followed Him no more because they couldn't endure that bloody gospel. They couldn't endure the message of the cross. They couldn't endure. See, I love John chapter 6. It's a display of the Jesus preached the message of the cross, even though in Paul's epistles we see it. That mystery revealed, you know, opened up. That mystery that was once hid in the old covenant is opened up in the new covenant. In Paul's epistles, we see the message of the cross, how he explains it for sanctification, justification, sanctification. Matter of fact, all the doctrines of the Bible. Paul gave us the fundamentals, the Apostle Paul. And there's preachers today that want to pull the rug out from the Apostle Paul. There's preachers today that want to talking negative about the Apostle Paul. But Christ gave the Apostle Paul the doctrines that we have in the Bible, the basics, the fundamentals. And praise God. Oh, it says right here, I was going somewhere, I lost my train of thought, but it says in verse 18, I say unto you that you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give unto you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatsoever you shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. And whatsoever you shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. I got to say this while I'm on it. You may already know it. You may have heard it. But there's been a lot of misunderstanding of this passage of Scripture. That's why we have the Catholic Church today. Because they have misunderstood this, that in the words of Jesus here, look at it in verse 18. He said, upon this rock, so he's talking about Jesus Christ himself, Jesus Christ and the message. But how do I know that? Well, if you just look at it from look at the Scripture, I think it explains it a little bit. If you look in the previous verses, the focus was on him. He said, who do you say I am? You know, if you look at that gist of it, you'd understand he's not talking about Peter as making a big deal about Peter. He said, upon this rock. See, Peter is not the first pope. The Catholics say that Peter was a pope. First of all, he wasn't a pope, and he wasn't the first pope, and he wasn't a pope, and that's not biblical. That's not scriptural for the papacy. That's not the true church, praise God. They say they are the church. I didn't come talk about the Catholic Church today. But if you can take it, you can make it. If you can take this preaching, you can make it. But that they want to make a doctrine out of the Catholic Church, you know, out of that. It said that Peter was the first pope. It says, upon this rock, with the word Peter, the name Peter means fragment of a rock. And in another place I read, it says, the word, it brings out stone. Peter means stone, I think, in the Greek. I'm not a Greek scholar or whatever, but I read somewhere else where it said that. And it says he's a fragment of the rock. Because I come to preach about the rock today. I didn't come to preach about Peter, but I come to preach about the rock. Hallelujah. And we got to be established on that rock. He says, I will build my church on that rock. How many of you know today that rock is Jesus Christ and Him crucified? Hallelujah. I'm not just saying that as a cliche because I'm so used to hearing preachers say it, but it is a fact that Jesus, the message of the cross, Jesus Christ and Him crucified is that rock. And we see, people would just do a study on Scripture, they would see that the rock is mentioned throughout. I mean, the Old Testament, Exodus 17, you know, that rock in the wilderness was a type of Christ. When Moses smote that rock, out of it came water to quench the thirst of millions of Hebrews. You know, water flowed out of that. That's a type of Christ being smitten on Calvary's cross. He was smitten. And when he was smitten, when he gave his life, you know, it says, Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was bruised for our iniquities, and by his stripes we are healed. There's a living water that we need to drink from. And this rock right here, he said, I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. That word prevail means overpower. It didn't say it wasn't going to come against. It didn't say it wasn't going to come against you. It didn't say that the devil is not going to fight you. It didn't say that people in the flesh is not going to fight you. It didn't say that they're not going to talk about it. It didn't say that things wouldn't happen to come against you, but it says it will not prevail against it. It will not overpower you. It will not overtake you. It will not take you under. You will not drown. Praise God. It says, I give unto you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Peter is not standing at the pearly gates with the keys, as some of your country songs like to say. Some of your songs you listen to like to say, oh, Peter's at the, Peter, I'm going to see St. Peter before I enter the gate, before I enter the city. And I see people don't know. They're ignorant of the Word of God. Because I read over in another place where it says it relates to all believers. In one of the other Gospels I read, I think it's in Matthew somewhere, I read on a few pages over, he said, I give unto you, and he was addressing generally, you believers as a whole, I give unto you the keys. That same verse is quoted again relating to all disciples, all believers. We all have authority. See, because see, the key is the cross. See, the faith in what Jesus done at the cross, faith is the key that unlocks that door. The key, if you just, you know, in a nutshell, the keys is Jesus Christ and Him crucified. Jesus is the kingdom. It's not, you know, you can't really
In other words, the whole word is all, it's all about Jesus. And I will give unto you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever you shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. In other words, it's meant for all believers. He's given us authority. He's given us authority to say unto yonder mountain, be thou removed, praise God. He's given us authority to tread over serpents. He's given us authority to in the name of Jesus, all believers, not just Peter. When I get to heaven, I don't have to ask Peter, can I come in? I can come boldly, praise God. I can come boldly right now to the throne of grace that I may find help and mercy in time of need. And then, and to show you the offense of the cross even more about Peter, we read over in 21. I'm gonna hurry up because I want to read some more scripture. I'm not gonna read all of that, but Peter got offended. He got, you know, very disturbed when Jesus stopped just talking about going to the cross, talking about going to Jerusalem to be killed, which has to do with the cross. He didn't like that. He didn't want Jesus to do that. So that shows you right there that people have they like Jesus when you just talk about Jesus. He's the Son of God. He's the Christ. But they don't want a suffering Messiah. They don't want one that, when we look at the cross, we see not only God's love. When we look at that cross, we see God in all of His holiness, that He's dying for me, dying for sinners, but we see a picture of us when we look at that cross. We see, you know, my sin put Him there. You see, that's how you have to view the cross. The right way to look at the cross is don't laugh and mock at it and say, oh, Jesus did it. He died. There's some event that happened 2,000 years ago. This man named Jesus died for the Jews or whatever the case. That's how I was before I got saved. I heard about Jesus. I would look at Jesus. I heard about Jesus. Oh, yeah, something happened 2,000 years ago. Yeah, this man named Jesus died for His people or whatever. And they said, if you just believe in Jesus. Oh, and I was just coasting along. I said, if you just believe in Jesus, you're okay. Just believe. And I did. In a sense, I thought I was okay. I believed in my mind, like Peter that day. But see, we got to come to the cross. In order to truly be saved, you have to embrace the cross. You have to realize He died for me on that cross. He did it for me. Don't say, well, He did it for so-and-so. And He did it for those. He did it for those burglars. He did it for those. And see, we want to look down on others and we think our sin is better than their sin. But He died for all. He died for all of our sins. And we have to take it personal, people. And maybe somebody on the sound of my voice today. That's why I'm preaching the salvation message as well, because it may be somebody on the sound of my voice today. You're not really looking at Jesus for who He is and what He done. You're not really seeing the cross for what it really means. Until you see what Jesus did on that cross and you take it personal that He died for you and you are a sinner, until you admit that you're a sinner, you cannot be saved. You have to admit that you are a sinner and there's nothing good in you. Because as long as you keep thinking there's something good in you, you'll keep going with the flow of the world. You have a little bit of this, a little bit of that. That's where the modern church is today. The modern church is having a little bit of Jesus. They like that part in the first part of Matthew 16. They like that. They're just like Peter. They like the fact if you just talk about Jesus as He's the Messiah, He's the Son of God. But if you don't accept the Jesus of the cross, you have another Jesus. And that's where the church is today. It's another Jesus, another gospel by another spirit, as he wrote about in 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Praise God. Okay, turn over with me to Matthew 7. Turn back to Matthew 7. Oh, Lord. Oh, thank you, Lord. Matthew 7. And the reason I'm opening up with these scriptures right here is because that will bring me to where I'm trying to get to, the point I want to bring out that I have. Matthew 7 is a similar thing. Now in Matthew chapter 16, we see it, he's talking about the church built upon a rock. We see it as a whole, the church built upon a rock. He said, "I will," and he said, "I'm the builder. I will build my church. I will build my church upon the rock, upon this rock." Now over in Matthew chapter 7, listen to this. Verse 24, "Therefore, whosoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken unto him a wise man who built his house upon a rock." Notice, a man and his house. Notice that. I just want to bring something out. A wise man built his house. A wise man which built his house. And I know we like to think in the natural that foundation, that the wood and the roof. But I want to take it down to where we are right now, spiritually. I want to take it down to as the scripture says, the jailer said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" And Peter said, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you shall be saved and your house." I want to try to preach what I feel like the Lord has given me today. He said, "Unto the wise man which built his house upon a rock, and the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. And everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does them not shall be likened unto a foolish man which built his house upon the sand. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. And then it came to pass, when Jesus had ended these sayings, that people were astonished at his doctrine, for he taught them as one having authority, and not as the scribes." See, the scribes is like the vast majority of the modern church today. They're just going through the motions, they're just going through their scripts or whatever, is going through the routine, and they're lording over the people. They're, you know, the Pharisees and the scribes, the Sadducees in that day. That's how they did. They was very pomp, religious pomp. But see, Jesus was different. How many of you know today that Jesus is different from religion? Jesus, see, when we go on a street corner somewhere and preach, when we go out there and preach, we tell them plainly, this is not religion. I'm not preaching religion today. If you want religion, you can go to any church in town. Just pick your church. You can get plenty of religion you want to get. But what we come out here today to preach to you is that you're a sinner. He loves you, but you're a sinner. He loves sinners, okay? We don't go out there and beat them over the head and say tell them how bad they are without giving them the answer, the solution. Say, you know, you're in need of a sinner. I mean, you're in need of a Savior because you're a sinner. And this is not about religion. This is about relationship. And that's what we preach. That's what we got to preach. We got to preach that. We can't just tell them, oh, it's okay. Just go to church. Just go find your church somewhere. Maybe 100 years ago, you might could tell them go find a church, because a lot of them was preaching the fundamentals. They was preaching Jesus Christ and the repentance. They was preaching hellfire. They was preaching a good salvation message and what little bit of living for God that they knew. But as you can't tell somebody that today. It's hard to just say go to church, because most of them ain't preaching that rock. They're not preaching. They're preaching a little bit of Lifeway bookstore it's popular. Lifeway bookstore is full of anything you want. It's going to be Jesus plus. It's not going to be Jesus Christ and what he did alone. It's a little bit of everything. It's a mixture. And God, how many today know God don't accept mixtures? You see, to go back along what I'm saying about taking it, if you can take it, you can make it. There's those in this message. And I may say some things that's kind of strong. Some of you may not like it, but I got to say it. There's people in this message of the cross. They claim they're preaching the message of the cross. They like a little bit of this and that. They're mixing things along. They're not really determined yet. They're not really. I'm not saying they're not saved. Don't leave here saying John said they're not saved and he thinks they're better. He's better than them. No, I didn't say that. But they're looking at it wrong, or they're hearing it wrong. There's something about it. Because it's hard. Like Peter, he had to. It's that moving from that transition from the flesh to the spirit, that, you know, they're still wanting to hang on to something that feels good, or something that makes mama happy, or something that, you know, well, that's just the way we've always done it. And they're trying to preach the message of the cross. And if they're preaching the cross, let me clarify, if they're preaching the cross for salvation, Somebody can get saved. they may get up for 30 minutes and preach the latest book report, but the last 5 minutes of that message, if they preach a salvation message, somebody can get saved. Because Jesus works through what He did at that cross. The Holy Spirit works through that. But they're mixing things to keep numbers. They're trying to get numbers in. I know I sound like a broken record. I hear this preaching all the time. I'm sure you do. If you've been here any length of time, you've heard some good preaching. You've heard some strong preaching. And I come today to just kind of reaffirm, to kind of reiterate and just reestablish, so to speak, if that's the word I can say, of what you have already, what God has already given you. I just come today to support what God is doing here, to support the man of God. Because like Peter, we can learn to be able to take it. We can learn that when we're rebuked, when we hear strong preaching, we won't get offended. You know, many said in John 6:60, this is a hard saying, who can hear it? And I looked over there in 2 Timothy 2:11, and Paul said, this is a faithful saying. That if you be, see, here's how you take it. I'm going to tell you how to take it. See, it's a hard saying to those that are looking at the cross wrong. They don't understand the message of the cross. They don't like the way to preach. You know, their eyes is on man. They don't like the way he said that or whatever the case. But when you come down to nitty gritty, when you realize, I need this message. He done brought me a long ways, and I don't want to go back to where I was. I don't want to go back to that vomit. And I can stand some strong preaching. I can stand a preacher that has some backbone, that stands on his hind leg. It don't offend me, because I know how the devil used to. I used to live for him. I used to live hard for him. And now, see, I can endure some hard preaching now. I can endure some hardships a little bit along the way. I've been through some things, and I'm not arrived. I won't come here to tell you I've arrived, but I've been through a lot of things, and I can say this not bragging, but I give God all the glory. I'm a little more patient, a little more, and I even say that as far as kids. this little newborn right here. I told my wife, I said, I can tell, I can just see God's hand in my own life. Since 11 years later, my youngest was 11. My youngest girl is 11. And I can tell you, like Brother Lawrence said about that temper, I had that temper for a long time. I mean, after being saved and even filled with the Holy Spirit, I had a problem with the temper. And I can honestly say today, it ain't as bad as it used to be. I mean, I can tell the Lord, I can tell you, I got a little bit more faith because of what I've been through with my kids. You know, the things I've been through with them, and I'm learning to have a little bit more, you know, I know this may say that's an aside thing. What's that got to do with the message? When I say take it, you got to be able to take it. You got to be able to take whatever comes your way. You got to be able to endure these things, whether it be things in your family or whatever the case, you know, whether it be the church. You know, we got to grow. That's why Peter was able to say, grow in grace. See, Peter was able to write about these things. And I found it interesting in 2 Peter 3:18, the very last verse in his epistles, he said, grow in grace. And the Lord, and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, he was able to say that because he himself had grown to the man of God that he was. And I noticed over in 1 Peter chapter 5, back where we was earlier, if you look up before the other verses, he talked about being clothed in humility, being clothed with humility. See, he learned to be humble. He learned to, and see, here's another thing. We've seen this over the years. We've seen people come to Crossway Ministries. They said they, and a lot of them was when Don was there. A lot of these things we've seen over the years. People have say they believe in this message, and they say, I listen to Sun Life Radio, and they'll come in and they'll stay for a little while. We'll go back to the parable of the sower, the seed and the sower, when the persecutions came. when the spouse wouldn't come in. Some of you may be going through some of that. Some of you, you know, I don't know, but your spouse, some of them that they couldn't endure. They just could not endure because there was animosity at the house or whatever the case. And we've seen some that couldn't remain. They went back to their Baptist church or wherever the case. And now they're just drying up. They're just, you know, they may be still saved. I'm not saying they're not saved, but we've seen that, and we've seen people come in. See, I'm trying to help y'all today. I'm trying to help y'all to be able to take it a little bit, to be able to endure the things that you're going through. If you don't, you're going to flee. I'm going to get to another verse in a minute, Isaiah 28. I'll go ahead and say it. Jesus was that tried stone. He's that precious cornerstone. And he that believes in him shall not make haste. You're not, see, if you just learn to, why I opened up with that scripture about, you know, after he has settled you. See, we got, when you get settled and established in this faith, and Peter used that word, I noticed throughout in other places in Peter, he used that word established. In 2 Peter chapter 2, he said, be established in this present truth. That truth is what he learned from Paul. He learned the message of the cross, you know, and he learned to be established in that. We've had people that come to Crossway Ministries, instead of just sitting down and learn, just sit down for a little while and learn, they immediately want to get on the pulpit. They immediately want the platform. There was a time, I'm going to tell you, I'll just share a personal testimony. I'm going to be real with you today. There was a time I was like, and that old flesh in me, Lord, am I ever going to get to preach? You know, and the devil was trying to tell me, you know, won't you say something? Just, you know, flesh wants to get out there. See, flesh, won't you just go to Brother Wayne and say, why come I can't preach? You know, that old flesh, you know, because there was a time I wasn't preaching, you know, Brother Wayne didn't ask me to preach for a long time. For a while there was a season. And there was a season of testing in my life. There was a season of not too long ago. There was a season of testing, some, you know, that I was going through. Of God was trying to get me to what. That's why Peter was able to write in 1 Peter 5. He said, "Humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, and He will exalt you in due season." But see, so many want to hurry up and start a church right when they get out of Bible college or whatever. They want to hurry up and they want to go to the church and try to get on the pulpit real quick, you know, and then they're always promoting themselves. I've learned part of humility. We got to be careful with this humility thing. We got to be careful. And I ain't saying that like a whoop puppy, you know. Don't beat yourself up. That's not humility. But Peter learned to just wait on the Lord. Peter learned to just sit down and learn from Paul. He listened to Paul. He learned to support the man of God. That's why he was able to say, our beloved brother Paul. See, he didn't get mad. He could have got mad in Galatians 2 there when Paul talked about Peter. Peter could have got mad and quit and said, he shouldn't have said that. Or when Jesus rebuked him, he could have got mad. He could have just quit. When Jesus called him Satan, in a sense, you know, not really, but he, through him, Satan was working through him. That's a spiritual lesson to teach us, that Satan is working through our flesh, through our self-will, to try to get us away from the cross. God, the devil wants you to get away from the cross, but we have got to learn to just wait on the Lord. And I've learned this, you know, over the years. I'm learning, I know you've called me to preach. And I still struggle with my preaching. I beat myself up sometimes by day. You know, I keep praying. I just blew it today. But any true preacher will say that. And even if you've been preaching for 40 years, there's going to be times, I could have said a little different today. But the point is, I can look back over my life and I think things, oh, hallelujah. I can praise the Lord. You know, there's a season in my life, you know, I was like, the devil was trying to get, he's just whispering things to me. Won't you know, there's times I was tempted to just quit. But see, Peter, through all he went through, he learned to humble himself. That's why he was able to stand boldly and tell the church to humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God. Now notice that phrase, mighty hand of God, has to do with God's, you know, God is in control. God is all powerful. God, just learn to to be under Him, under His authority, under His love and care, His mighty hand. Praise God. Just humble yourself. Just sit there. Praise God. And let Him, He'll speak to you today. If you'll let Him. Okay, praise God. Praise God. Moving along for time's sake. Over in Philippians. Real quick. I'm trying to get to, I know the Lord told me this morning, He woke me up and He confirmed some things to me that I wanted to try to get to. There's plenty of other information and material I have here. I don't know if I'll get to it, but I want to try to simplify it if I can. But notice in Matthew 16, we see the church is built upon that rock. Jesus is the builder. Then Matthew 7 goes down to the individual believer, the individual Christian, and you can include his house. The believer needs to be built on that. He needs to build his faith needs to be established on that rock. See, it talks about proper faith. The correct object of faith must be Jesus Christ and Him crucified. And then I want to look at the preacher that has been set. There's 3 points I want to bring out. The church built upon the rock, the believer that's built upon the rock, and the preacher that has been set to preach and defend that rock. Look over Philippians 1. Praise God. Because the message I feel like the Lord has given me is for this church. Specifically, I've sought the Lord. It's for this church. If there's somebody in that come in that's not saved today, that's why it's going to be a little bit of old-fashioned salvation preaching too. Because if you're not saved today, you need to give your heart to Jesus Christ before you can even be established, before you can even get established in the faith and remain to sit under His loving care. To humble yourselves, you first have to be saved. You have to give your heart to Jesus. But we see in Paul, and why Peter was able to write it as boldly as he did. Peter wrote a lot about false doctrine. See, there's a grace today that's going out. I know you've heard this, but you're going to hear it again. There's a grace going out, you know, about, you know, you don't have to confess sin and you shouldn't preach against this and that. You know, you shouldn't, you know, you're judging if you preach against false doctrine. You know, what you shouldn't say that. Just leave them alone. Just leave them alone. That's what a lot of church wants you to do. It's what a lot of your family wants you to do. It's what a lot of the so-called Christians want you to do is just shut up. Don't say nothing. You just let God handle it all. Don't say nothing. But the same one that wrote about grace, Peter, and over there in his epistles, he said a lot about grace. You know, we stand in this grace. He said, this is the true grace of God. And I know now, looking back, because of this message that's going out today, this grace, this hyper grace that's going out around today in the modern church, I believe the Holy Spirit, of course He did, He looked into the portals of history in the future, and He's seen that there was going to be this coming up, and that's why He had Peter write, this is the true grace of God. And I want to put emphasis on that, because the same one that said this is the true grace of God, he also wrote about false doctrine. He wrote about those that, he said, there will come rising those that will follow after heresies and, you know, damnable doctrines. He talked about that. He talked about many shall give heed to, you know, damnable doctrines, heresies and things. And the same one, you know, and like people ask, well, who do you think you are to be able to preach and say this about this? Well, the same one that denied 3 times the Lord. In the same chapter, I think it's 2 Peter 2, the same one that said, my Lord, let me get it real quick. Praise the Lord. I think it may be 2 Peter 2 or, praise God. It says, but there were false prophets among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you, who privily shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord who brought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. See, you say, what gives Peter the right to say that, because he denied the Lord. See, that's why I say he was growing. He, the same one that denied the Lord, he boldly said, they're denying the Lord. See that? See that? The same one, because people say, who do you think you are, Don, to get stand up and preach like you do? Because he was called of God, first of all. God has called him to preach. He called Don, he called Peter, he called Paul, and second of all, because he's been forgiven much. He's, because of the grace of God, he was restored. He was restored. I started to say in John 21 earlier, I got off track about in John 21, you know, he said, I go a fishing. You know, after you know, being with the Lord, after the resurrection, he didn't see the resurrected Lord. After seeing the resurrected Lord, he still didn't understand a lot. He didn't understand what he came to do at the cross. He knew that he risen from the dead. He knew that. He seen him. He seen him rise again. But self was still wanting to get in the way. He said, I go fishing. He said, I'm just going back to my, what I've always, he's just so accustomed to doing that. I'm just going back, you know, to fishing. You know, we don't know what all was going through his mind. You know, why he said that. But we know there's still self, there's still self-will there. But to show you the love of Jesus, I mean, Jesus is over there waiting on the shore for him. He tells him to cast it on the right side, cast that net on the right side of the boat, and you shall find. That's another message for another day. But I want to say this, cast your nets on the right side. You've been casting on the wrong side, but put your faith in the right object. Jesus Christ and him crucified has to, and he was just reminding Peter that I'm still with you. I still can perform for you. I can still provide for you. I still love you. And he's over there cooking for him, cooking fish, waiting on him on the shore. And when John said, you know, it's the Lord, Peter, I love this. I could just picture in my mind the love. Because see, he had been through some things with Jesus. He knew that Jesus had restored him. You can see that look of love in Jesus' eyes. I can picture that when Jesus was being led to Golgotha, when Jesus was led out of judgment hall, going to the cross, going to Golgotha, Peter, the Bible says Jesus looked at Peter. He just looked at him. I could just see that look of love in his eyes. I don't see a look of, I told you he was going to do it. Now you just get out of here and don't ever follow me no more. But you just picture that. Jesus, that look of love in his eyes. Oh, that look of love. And that's why he was able to say, though, about those that denied the Lord, and he preached the gospel, because he knew he had denied him and he had been restored, and he's warning the church now about those that's coming in, you know, this bringing in heresies. But when John said it's the Lord, and Peter, the Bible says he jumped in the water, he couldn't wait to get to his Lord. Hallelujah. That's another message for another day. But I'm just trying to talk a little bit about Peter, how he's our example. He learned to be humble. God humbled, the Lord humbled him. He didn't give up. He knew that, because the Lord had shown that grace. He poured that grace, that love on him. He showed him, and he reminded him of the call when he said, Peter, feed my sheep, you know. And I'm not going to get into the agape and the phileo and all that, but he said, you know, but you know the story there. He said, he just basically reminded him of the call. He reminds Peter of the call to feed my sheep. He didn't give up on Peter. And he's not giving up on you today. I don't know who this is for, but he's not giving up on you. You might have been going through some things, but just like Peter learned to humble himself instead of running. Don't run from this rock. Don't run from this one. See, because he's been tried. Okay, oh, where am I going? Thank you, Jesus. Let me get to where I was going. Philippians. Hope this is not boring, y'all. Praise God. Philippians chapter 1. Philippians chapter 1. I almost went past it. Praise God. Remember I told you the 3 points, that I'm going to bring out 3 points. The church built upon the rock. And Jesus boldly said the gates of hell will not come again, will not prevail against my church. So there's going to be a remnant. There's going to be a remnant. He's got a remnant. He's always had a remnant. And he's got a remnant today. The gates of hell shall not prevail against my church, those whose faith is in the rock. Jesus Christ and him crucified, who's established, who's staying right there. And then in Matthew 7, the believer needs to build his house upon that rock and his house. And then over here, we need to look at the preacher, the one that God has called to establish that rock, to make it firm. To look at this in verse 7, even as it is meet, Philippians 1, even as it is meet for me to think this of you all, because I have you in my heart. Notice the heart of a pastor right here. I have you in my heart, inasmuch as both in my bonds and in the defense, a word that people don't like today, you know, in the defense and confirmation of the gospel, you all are partakers of my grace. He boldly said, my grace, because he learned, just like he said in two or three places, he said, this is my gospel. He established over in Romans 16, he said, he is able to establish you according to my gospel. See, we got to be established according to Paul's gospel. And I want to say Paul's gospel is Jesus Christ and him crucified, the gospel. And I want to take it personal and say that's my gospel too. That's my gospel. Jesus Christ and him, those that, as Jesus told Peter, I give unto you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And we can take it personally. Those of us that believe this rock, I feel the prayer, I feel it right now, the presence of God. Those of that believe this message, and God has called you where you are. He's called you to preach. He's called you. You may not be standing behind this pulpit, but he's called you to, he wants you to remain, he wants you to be humble, he wants you to learn to humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, he wants you to be settled and strengthened. And Paul said he is able to establish you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ in Romans 16. Right after he warned about false doctrine, he warned about, you know, mark those that cause divisions, those that's not preaching my gospel. See, that's why we got to look. We got to rightly divide the word of truth. You see, it's not, it had nothing to do with those that's just nitpicking, those that's causing divisions. And so he rightly divided when he said, mark them that cause divisions contrary to the doctrines which you have learned and avoid them. Then he said he's able to establish you according to my gospel. So, you know, and Paul, see, people say, well, Paul was arrogant too, just like today. People are going to say Don's arrogant. They're going to say you're arrogant. They're going to say all this kind of stuff about you too, just like they did Paul. They did Peter the same way, because Paul boldly said, that which I received, I didn't receive it by man, but by revelation of Jesus Christ. And if any man come preaching any other gospel than that which we have preached unto you. Notice he says we. He wasn't trying to make a name for himself. He said, we preach Christ crucified, him and Timothy. I'm going to get to Timothy in a minute. I'm going to try to get to Timothy in a minute too. Praise God. I'm trying to go somewhere with this. He said, it's in my heart. See, a true pastor, a true preacher, he is like Jeremiah. He's got fire in his bones and tears in his eyes. He's going to stand up and say, I got you in my heart for the defense and confirmation of the gospel. I believe everywhere Paul went, he did two things. He defended and confirmed. Everywhere Paul went, he didn't just preach that positive message that some of you want to hear. Some of you may not like the preaching. Some of the preaching's being gone. I don't know if I would have said it like that. He should have said it a little different. Why don't he just be more positive? But I believe everywhere Paul went, he defended. That's what he said. I am set. Over, look at verse 17. Well, let me read on, because this is important. It goes. I need to read up to 17, because it's something I want to bring out. Praise God. I hope y'all get some out of this. It says, for you are all partakers of my grace, for God is my record, how greatly I long after you all in the bowels of Jesus Christ. And this I pray, that your love may abound yet more and more in knowledge and in all judgment. Oh, we can say a lot about that. The love, and I would that your love may abound yet more and more in knowledge and in all judgment. That needs to be proper love, that you may approve things that are excellent, that you may be sincere and without offense till the day of Christ, being filled with the fruits of righteousness, which are by Jesus Christ unto the glory and praise of God. But I would you should understand, brethren, that the things which happened unto me have fallen out rather unto the furtherance of the gospel, so that my bonds in Christ are manifest in all the palace and in all other places. And many of the brethren in the Lord, waxing confident by my bonds, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. When I read that this morning, I was thinking about Don. I was thinking about Brother Wayne. By their stance they've had, and others like them that have stood and preached the way they do, it has done something to me. It has encouraged me to be more bold. And I'm not trying to preach like them. It's not like a parody. I'm not trying to parody. But it's in, see, when you see a man of God, remember I told you earlier about how you look at the cross matters. It's important how you hear. We got to take heed what we hear and how we hear. Because there was some, as we're going to read on, there was some that had envy and strife. They didn't like Paul, but they claimed they were preaching Jesus. But Paul was humble to say, well, if they're preaching Jesus, so, you know, he went on to say that. He said, but nevertheless, Jesus Christ is preached. But still, there was some that didn't like Paul, just like there's some that don't like us today. But he took note of those that are much more bold to speak the word without fear. He took note. He said, many of the brethren in the Lord waxing confident by my bonds. And they wasn't ashamed of his bonds. There's another place I read where he says, don't be ashamed of the Lord nor of me, his servant. You know, don't be ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, neither of me, his servant. Don't be ashamed. Don't be ashamed of what you got here today, church. Don't be ashamed. Are you going to stand with the man of God here? Because that's the point I want to bring out in closing here in a few minutes. You know, we need to be established on that rock, the church as a whole. God has got a remnant that's not going to allow, that's not going to quit. The gates of hell is not going to prevail against them. No matter what comes your way, you're going to be tested. The devil's going to tell you through persecutions, through temptations. You know, in the parable of the sower, you know, that there's times of temptation. But in Luke 8:13, I'm just looking at my notes. In Luke 8:13, there's time of temptation, and those had no root. If you ain't rooted and grounded and settled, if you're not rooted in the faith, grounded and settled, as Colossians brings out, if you're not rooted in this, you will, through time of temptation, through something, oh, I can't believe it. There was a man coming to, when Don was preaching at Crossway, there was a friend of ours that came for a while. He actually joined the church. He actually went up front and said he wanted to be a member. He joined the church, and he was there for a few weeks, and it wasn't long after that he quit, and he told me on the phone, I don't like the way Don said that. I don't like the way Brother Don, he got offended at something Brother Don said. He didn't like the way Don said that. I don't know. It didn't offend me. I mean, it didn't strike a nerve in me, because I'm just, my eyes is on Jesus. My eyes is on the message of the cross. There's been times, see, I want to bring this out. It's very important. It's very important that you understand what I'm about to say, because there's going to be times your flesh ain't going to like something that's said. Some of you may already be in the valley of decision right now. Some of you may be talking to somebody today. You're thinking about leaving, or you thought about it. Hey, I'll be honest. There's been times that old flesh, you know, I don't tell everybody this, but I've talked to my wife, you know, I don't tell everybody this, but I ain't going to tell you what it was. I ain't going to go in detail, but I say, I just don't, well, maybe I would have said it a little bit different. I don't know if I would have said it quite like that. And see, the devil would take those things, if you're not grounded in this message and you're not focused on the vision. The vision, God gave us a message a few years ago about the vision of souls, of the harvest. That's why Don and others are starting to go out preaching. And I come to tell you today to get on board with the vision here at Word of the Cross Ministries. Get on board, because if your eyes are not on the vision, the greater vision, not Don, don't look at Don, don't look at other. Your eyes have got to be on the vision for souls. For where there is no vision, the people perish. And there is God has given a vision for Southaven. There's a vision. That's why God called them. God specifically called them here. And Brother Wayne said the other night, on Wednesday night, he said, I know that the Lord called Sister Debbie and I from Ripley, Tennessee, to start a church here. And he boldly said to us, he said, And if you're not on board, he said, I know we're in God's will. He said, there was times I did not want to be here in Greenwood, Mississippi. He said, I love it in them hills. He loves the mountains. He loves the hills. He said, I love it up there. But he said, I know God has called me and Debbie here. And he boldly told us, we're in God's will. And if you don't get on board with what God is doing here, you're out of God's will. If you know God is calling, let me specify, if you know God has called you here. Now, if God ain't calling you here, then you're not out of His will if God tells you to go to another church that's preaching the message. I want to clarify that. If they're preaching the message, you know, He's not going to cause you to be a lone ranger and do a new work that's not having anything to do with the vision of, you know, if you're not going to support, because there's many that claim they support the message of the cross, but they don't support us. They don't like Brother Wayne. They don't like Don. You know, for whatever the reason, they don't like the way they said this, or they can't get over something that happened in the past, or whatever, you know, just whatever the case. You know, there's many things we have seen these things happen over the years, but we need to get back. I'm trying to give you a message today with the help of the Lord. We need to focus on the vision. But Brother Wayne said, if God has called you here to this church and you don't get involved with what God is doing, you're not getting on board, then you're out of God's will. I mean, if God has called Don and Carrie here, I'm just trying to encourage you. I'm trying to challenge you today to seek the Lord's face, ask Him what He wants you to do, because there's souls out there. Don ordered him a bullhorn. He can't wait to go out there, praise God, because he knows it's not just about him. It's not just about these four walls. It's not just about his family. It's about the souls, and that's what we got to get involved. But let me read on. I'm about to come to a close. Praise God. It says, see, some were able to have more boldness because they was encouraged and challenged by Paul's ministry. They seen how he was bold. So it says in verse 14, they were much more bold to speak the word without fear. Some indeed preached Christ even of envy and strife, and some of also of good will. The one preached Christ of contention, not sincerely. See, some just want to, they just want to stir up contention. They just want to, you know, some are looking for fault, you know, some, and some have their own agenda. As the note brings out, if you have expositors, it says some have their own agenda. You know, some are just wanting to, you know, stir up contention. The one preached Christ of contention, not sincerely, supposing to add afflictions to my bonds. Somebody wrote Brother Wayne a letter one time and said, I wish you would just die. That's how people are. I won't go into detail, but somebody wrote Brother Wayne a letter, sent him a letter to his address, to his house, that I just wish you would, I even pray you would die. And he claims, he preached the message of the cross or believed in the message of the cross. That's how people are. They just don't like certain preachers because their eyes is on, they're offended. They are the offense of the cross. It's what it all boils down to. They are offended. They done got offended. Somebody done struck a nerve. Somebody done, that's why, look, I love y'all today. I know Brother Don loves you. He loves you. Now, don't let this message offend you. Don't get your eyes on Don. Praise God. Get your eyes on the message. It says that the one preached Christ of contention, not sincerely, supposing to add affliction to my bonds, but the other of love, knowing that I am set for the defense of the gospel. See, that's the thing right there. When you truly have your eyes on the vision, when you truly have your eyes on the prize, Jesus Christ and Him crucified, you'll learn. I've been with them for 8 years now at Crossway Ministries. I have been through it with Brother Wayne. I've been through it, you know, as he went through things, I've been through it. You know, I've seen people come and go by handfuls. I have seen them come and go. I've seen them get mad. We've seen some come in there wanting the pulpit, and Brother Wayne, see, if he don't know you, Brother Wayne's a man of God. He ain't going to let somebody come up on the pulpit just because they said they're called to preach. He wants you to sit down for a little while, and he wants to get to know you. You know, and people immediately want the pulpit, and Brother Wayne boldly said, God, he said, I'm preaching. God has called me. call me pastor of this church, I'm preaching, you know, so just, you know, just sit down, you know, you can just hear the message. But they don't like that. There's been two or three that did that. They wanted the pulpit, and Brother Wayne didn't let them preach. And they never come back. And I don't know where they are today, but I don't know what they're doing. I'm not taking their salvation. I don't know what they're saved or not, but you know, we've seen that over the years. We've seen a lot of things happen over the years. And I'm just trying to encourage you today. See, the other of love, knowing that I am set, I'm going to close with this. I am set for the defense of the gospel. That phrase, I am set, is very significant. It means a lot. First of all, go back to verse 7. It says, the defense and confirmation of the gospel. The word confirmation means documentation, evidence, a testimony of validation. He wanted to make it plain what the gospel was, and it means to make firm, to establish, confirm, make sure. See, it was plain, black and white. That's kind of preaching I want. That's why I respect Brother Wayne. That's why I admire people like him and Brother Don, because they're gonna give it to you. Like it is. They ain't going to beat around the bush. And that's what Paul did. If we just get into Scripture, Paul did the same thing. That's what Peter did. That's what Jesus, for those that say, what about Jesus? Jesus did. My Lord, we can talk about Jesus if you want to. That's what I come to preach about is Jesus. Jesus called the Pharisees brood of vipers and dead, full of dead man's bones and all. He called because they was hypocrites. They was self-righteous, and he preached to them. He told them to repent. Praise God. And we need to repent today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want to have an attitude of repentance to those hyper-grace people, whatever they want to say. I want to say, if you don't have an attitude of repentance, if you don't keep yourself humbly, that's why Peter was able to write about the grace of God, because he humbled himself and he realized that he wasn't worthy. And that's how we got to be. We got to be like it. Are you going to follow suit with those in these fallacies? There's going to be a lot of fallacies out there that's pulling people away. We've seen people that preach this message. We've seen them they start reading other books. They're meddling around. They're meddling around with other books, and they see something that's almost true or is close or whatever the case. But then they just, I don't know. I don't know what they're doing today. I'm not trying to talk about them. I'm not saying they're not saved. I'm not saying they don't love the Lord. But we've seen, for whatever reason, they ain't with us no more. That they ain't preaching the message. To my knowledge today, they have heard something else. There's a mixture. There's something else. But see, we can know what the truth is if we get in the Word of God. That's why I said on the program, the broadcast of Contending for the Faith, I have said this stuff is a no-brainer. Some of this stuff is just as plain no-brainer to me. I mean, it's obvious. Some of this stuff is just obvious, because, I mean, what I keep going back to is what John said in 1 John 2:24. Let that therefore abide in you which you have heard from the beginning. If that which you have heard from the beginning shall remain in you, you shall continue in the Father. That's one of my favorite verses. It's one of the first ones I learned when I got saved. You know, if you would just abide in that, just keep going back to your first love. Just stay at your first love, people, and then you won't be led astray. A lot of people are getting led astray because they're leaving their first love. That's the bottom line. They're leaving their first love, But see, Paul said, I am set, and I'm coming to a close, for the defense of the gospel. That he says, I am set. That means of things put or set in any place, fixed, solid, destined, appointed, ordained, called. In other words, I am this God. Before I was formed in my mother's womb, God had called me to preach this gospel. I am set. I am set for the defense of the gospel. And I'm coming to an end. Y'all bear with me. Over there, I told you I'm going to talk about Timothy. Philippians 2. I like what he said about Timothy. Praise God. Hallelujah. He says, but I trust in the Lord Jesus, 8:19, 19. But I trust in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy shortly unto you, that I also may be of good comfort when I know your estate. For I have no man like-minded who will naturally care for your state. For all seek their own, not the things which are of Jesus Christ, but you know the proof of Him. Hallelujah. That as a son with the Father, He has served with me and the God. I love that. My Lord, I want to be accounted among the faithful today. I want to be among Paul. I read over in Acts chapter 17, it says some of them clave unto Paul. There was many that did not like Paul. They did not accept over in Athens on Mars Hill when Paul preached. Many turned away. They didn't want to hear what he had to say. They didn't like him, whatever. But it says some of them clave. I love that. They clave. The word clave means they stuck like glue to Paul. And I'm here to tell you, if God has called you here today, He wants you to support the man of God. He wants you to stick like glue to the man of God. He wants you to get behind him and get beside him. Don't try to get in front of him. Don't try to get in front of the man of God. God wants you to just humble yourself today. He wants you to get behind the man of God. He wants you to cleave if he's preaching the truth. You know, qualify that. As long as he's preaching the truth. If he starts preaching something else, run. But as long as he's preaching the truth, you need to get behind him and get beside him, walk beside him, praise God. And Timothy was one of those, praise God. Over in, three, real quickly. Three, and then I got to close. I know I got to close. That's one thing I've always had a hard time trying to close. Philippians 3, welcome to the ministry. Any preacher, I tell you that. And I won't tell you that Don said, go as long as I want to. But then he also said, you got metal chairs. So he said, y'all got metal chairs, so I know you're ready to go. All right, Philippians 3, 14 through 19. It says, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Let us therefore, as many as be perfect, be thus minded. And if anything you be otherwise minded, God shall reveal even this unto you. Nevertheless, whereunto we have already attained, let us walk by the same rule. Let us mind the same things. If you do a study in Galatians 2, 12 through 18, I don't have time to go there. You'll see that rule, that straight line, that line of the cross, that, as brother said, cross line. That's where he got the name of cross line. He looked in Galatians 6. You see, you know, we need to walk by that rule. And if we walk by that line, that straight line, the message of the cross, we'll be in the same mind with, like Paul. We'll be with Paul. We'll be with Paul and Timothy. He said, let us mind the same thing. Then, brothers, be followers together of me, fellow imitators, and mark them which walk so as you have also us for an example in sample. For many walk, of whom I have told you often and now tell you weeping, Paul was weeping, that they are enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, whose glory is their shame, who mind earthly things. And I'll stop right there in my reading. But temptation's going to come. There's going to be persecution. I'm just kind of going through the same storms. You got to be able to take these things. Trials, persecutions. You got to be able to take strong preaching. You got to take some strong. You got to be able to take a little bit of that strong preaching. I've learned over 8 years I've been with Brother Wayne to take some strong preaching. If you can take Brother Wayne and Brother Don, you welcome to military. Welcome to the army. Welcome to, that's why Paul told Timothy, be a good soldier. Be a good soldier in this race. We got to have patience. Run this race with patience. I just want to keep on preaching. We got so many scriptures. We got to run this race with patience. The word patience means endurance. And how do we endure? I got to close with how to tell you how to take it. If you take it, you'll make it. How do you take it? By looking unto Jesus. He said, run this race with patience. The word patience means endurance. And then he goes on to say, I found a neat, it's an interesting word study there. Because he says, who endured the cross, despising the shame, and he endured such contradiction of sinner. We didn't have to endure the cross. He endured that blood. He endured that the beatings in the cross. He endured it for you and I, and that's how we endure. We keep looking unto Jesus. Get your eyes off of man. Get your eyes off of the church. You know, but
and focus on what God has called here at Cross Word of the Cross Ministries. And I just want to encourage you and challenge you today. Fall in love with this Jesus, this truth, and the message of the cross, and get your eyes on the prize, on the vision that God has in Southaven. And we're going to give an altar call. You can play however you want to play. Praise God.
Yes. We can go through those trials and be victorious in Christ Jesus. That trial is not the end. That trial is just going to be a praise report in the end. It's going to be a testimony of what God has done in your life, how faithful Jesus Christ is to us as church. Yes. And there's no temptation that is, that He hasn't endured also. And yes. He knows our infirmities, and He can help us. He gives us that victory, and He gives us that grace and that help, so that when we go into that furnace, we come out, and those things that were binding us before are gone. Amen.
Amen. Praise God. That's good. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Just play. Just let Him have His way today. Yes, just worship Him, church. Hallelujah. Lord, have your way today. Whatever you have need of today, praise God. Let Him have His way with you. Just worship Him. God is raising up an army in these last days. Hallelujah. We're here to pray with you. And every one of you. I want to have God's way. I want Him to have His way with you right now. As she plays softly, I just want you to search your heart, examine your heart today. We all have to do that. We have to constantly do that. It's not just a one-time thing. The Bible says, guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. The devil
what he did with Peter, what he did with Paul, what he's doing with me. He's done, he's tested me. The things, he's whispered things in my ears. He's going to do that with you today, people. He's going to try to move you away. Chapter 1 says, be not moved away from the hope of the gospel. The devil's going to try to get you off. He's trying to get you moved away. Praise God. He's trying to move you away. We've seen it happen. We've seen him move people in this message. Don't think that you're standing. Take heed lest you fall. If you think you stand, take heed lest you fall. Examine your heart daily. He loves you today. We're not here to beat you up. We're here to tell you today he can restore you. If you need healing, you need the baptism of the Holy Spirit, just ask him to fill you. Don't give up. Don't quit. I sought him for 10 months before I was baptized. I didn't come to preach that today, but I want to say it today. Don't quit, but ask for all that God wants you to have. It took me 10 months, and one day in my bed, I was baptized with the Holy Spirit, laying in bed. He can baptize you wherever you are, if you want it, if you're hungry enough today. Oh, hallelujah. Let him fill you. Let him make you what he wants you to be. We got to be established and rooted in this faith. If you need prayer today, we want to ask you. I want to ask you to, if you need prayer, whatever it is, you can come up if you want to. If anybody needs prayer, don't wait till Don gets back. You don't have to wait to a special occasion. Praise God. If you need prayer today, we will pray the prayer of faith over you today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Whatever it is, you don't have to tell me about it. Praise the Lord. Just give it to the Lord. Amen. Amen. I want him to have his way today. Hallelujah. Just lift your hands and begin to praise him. Hallelujah. I want you to have your way, Lord, today. I thank you, Lord, for what you did today. Lord, bless your people. That we'll be established in this faith. We'll be rooted and grounded and settled in this message of the cross, Lord. This is the only message you have. Hallelujah. It's the only one that works. The only truth that works. Hallelujah. To save the sinner from hell and to save the saint from going back to where they were. To help us to grow, Father. Hallelujah. Oh, touch your people today. I pray when they leave this place today, Lord, they'll leave with a greater vision. They'll leave with encouragement. They'll leave with Lord, that they have one more layer added, so to speak, of your grace. I'm not saying it well, but they have one more. It's another page in the book. Hallelujah. It's been turned. Understanding now, I realize how more important it is. How I see the vision even more, how serious this is, Lord, because you said that the devil is a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. That's why Peter was able to say that, because he almost was taken under. Jesus said, I have prayed for you, Peter, that your faith fail not. And you're praying for us. You're pulling for us. And you said you have a great cloud of witnesses that have went on before us. That's why you said endure it. That's why you said run this race with patience, because there's a faithful cloud of witnesses who endured it. And Peter is one of those that endured it. Hallelujah. I thank you, Lord. I thank you for your presence. I thank you for your victory in this house today, Lord. I sense victory in this house. There is, oh God, there's liberty in this house. You have raised this church up, and the gates of hell will not prevail. Hallelujah. Oh God, I'm asking you today to bless the finances of this ministry. I'm asking you to bless those in need today, Lord. Provision. There is provision, people, in the cross. There's provision in the cross. Hallelujah. Oh, thank y'all for coming today. Let him touch you. Let him touch you today. Hallelujah. Glory to God in Jesus' mighty name. We
to stay as long as you want. I'm not trying to rush it. I want the Lord. That's one thing I'm learning, you know, in this, as I opened up with from that verse, the reason I opened up with that verse about suffering in the flesh, so he can learn to establish. One thing I'm learning is to let the, I want the Holy Spirit to have his way. Oh, I want him to have his way. I don't want to rush. I'm learning that, people. I'm still learning that. I'm still learning how to let the Holy Spirit. Oh, God, in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Oh, let him touch you. Just lift up your hands. He can feel you today. Right where you stand, just lift up your hands and give it to him. Whatever the need is, that job, just lift up your hands. He can give you a job. He can fill you with the Holy Spirit. It's here today. We're claiming it today in Jesus' name. Because you've given unto all of us, Lord, the keys of the kingdom. Not just Peter. You've given us all access. You said we have received access by grace, faith into this grace wherein we stand and we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Let him fill you today. Just begin to speak whatever you sense right now. In the name of Jesus, just give it to him right now. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I thank y'all for coming out. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.